6 o'clock. I'll just say welcome to the new members we've got on the committee. Hope you're having an enjoyable time during the next 12 months. We always do. Members' code of conduct for any declarations of interest. Item 2, minutes of the last meeting. Stuart.
There's just three items that I didn't want to lose sight of, really, to reflect the minute, which don't seem to arise elsewhere in the agenda that I've addressed the problem to speak about. The first issue I just wanted to ask you was on page 3, minute 58, I recall that we discussed the issue of the hydro maintenance debts in terms of the £1.6 million that was written off by the government, because it was suggested the council acted outside of the New Motor Streamlet Act. The minutes suggest that the matter will be picked up in future reports, but there doesn't seem to be a date or a sort of time scale on that. The second issue, shared just on minute 60, the local orders of Catalonia. Again, just with it seems to be hanging in the air, this idea that we need to be looking to appoint independent members when regulations or guidance are issued. I don't know whether this might be a moment for Officer Pope to comment on that. And finally, Chair, I've noticed in the agenda itself there's no quarterly report on the Regulation of Investigatory Powers Act. It's quarterly, so clearly we're missing a report covering the period 1st of March. To the 1st of June, and indeed after the discussion we had last time, there was some issue that officers were going to look to apply to magistrates to use the powers to investigate the criminal offence of houses. So there were three issues that I think are sufficiently important enough that don't appear to be reflected elsewhere in the agenda, and we will need to have some comments on them.
Okay, thank you. Respond in relation to the highways issue, if you'd like to break, Councillor. We are scheduled to undertake some follow-up work in mid-July. So the findings in that report will either be included in the monthly summary report for possibly either the July report or the August one. If not, we'll come back with a more detailed response at the next meeting in September. But you said you will get feedback on that. We haven't sort of forgotten about it, but it was just too soon in the process for us to be sort of come back to this meeting.
Thank you, Chair. In regards to the remaining two items, insofar as the independent members, we're still awaiting the guidance from Mr. Justice, so once we have that, I will provide notes to members of the committee to update on that position. And insofar as the RIPA authorisations, apologies for the inflation report, hasn't been provided because of the June not being completed, but what I will do is provide information to members of the committee.
Inspired by
update and then
bring a more comprehensive report to the next meeting.
Okay,
Lucia. Yeah, I think you're not on the bit. Well, I don't want to leave the points, but the would have been 1st of March to 1st of June for this quarter. And then the next quarter would have been 1st of June to 1st of August. It would have been the September results in second. It shows that it's a statutory requirement for them to be causing the reports, which were happening all last year. It's just a notable absence. And also, given that we've raised the issue of ordinary discussion around the issue of harassment and the potential to achieve those results, to come up with that, because it would have been
Item 3 is the government statement. Are you doing this,
Joe? Thank you. Minute 59 actually does refer to this report, so we did bring back on this one, thank you for it. Really pleased to bring to members' attention. issues and income statements. And that's a good thanks to Mark and his team, to Lucy Barrow for putting this together in the framework in which you agree at our last meeting. The actual approach that we've taken this year has been to provide a heavy weight of evidence in terms of our governance improvement journey over the past 12 months, and hopefully the AGS provides you with some evidence of that for yourselves to look at. The principal reason for drawing it to your attention this evening is to provide an opportunity to be discussed and debated and provide contributions to it ahead of the formal presentation of it in its final form in September. In terms of the evidence, 3.2 highlights particularly the work that we've undertaken with internal audits and indeed a further group of chief officers and officers within the council, which have paid attention to in the report itself, which has demonstrated both the direction of travel that we've taken in terms of our governance arrangements, but equally in terms of what we've done to address some of the concerns that this committee particularly were concerned about, principally based on the improvement team and also the improvement board and also the peer review. So in terms of the annual governance statement itself, I think what I'd like to highlight is from section 3 onwards in terms of the progress made during 13-14. I think one of the statements that I made there is significant in that we have made significant progress in addressing our weaknesses in governance arrangements. And again, I'll highlight some of those areas which we can demonstrate absolute progress in that area. You'll see over the page on page 14 that in 2012-13 our AGS actually identified 15 significant issues relating to council's governance arrangements. We did put in place an action plan, we brought that here for your attention. We continue to monitor that team chaired by myself with contributions from right across the directorates. We've met on a monthly basis, and I'm pleased to say that of those particular 15 significant service areas, the 8 governance issues have been completed or significant progress has been made during 2013-14. And of the remainder, substantial progress has been made to actually overturn those 15 significant issues. Now just to 3 which are highlighted as part of the our continuing improvement journey, which are part of the appendix to this particular report. It's also interesting to note that in terms of those three governance issues, they are considered to be significant, but we'd have to say that these are actually what we determine to be significant. I'm pleased to say that over the past 12 months, we've not had any intervention from any government or non-governmental agency about any significant risks or concerns. So I think it demonstrates a mature approach to the way that we're taking our government arrangements and actually taking care of the wrongs ourselves and making those improvements therein. In terms of the governance framework under paragraph 4 and beyond, you'll see that in terms of what we've adopted as is the principles, the SOX guidance, we've actually focused on those. And hopefully, I won't want to draw attention to all of them because I think there's plenty of evidence within the annual government statement this year about progress that's been made. We can see that we've strengthened our financial management system. We know that we balanced our budget in 2013-14. We are heading this year, which gives us a strong basis for our planning transformation programme. We're aware of the risk that we're tasked in terms of the significant savings we have to make, but we have the future council programme, which is actually managing that in a far more robust and focused and corporate way. Our business planning framework and performance management policy is up and running. Our performance appraisal process for all offices, from the chief executive downwards, is now in place and is beginning to be embedded. We do have a partnership risk register and toolkit in place, and also we have also achieved some significant support, I think, from outside, well, in terms of seeing that Wirral was actually selected as one of our areas to participate in the Public Service Transformation Network, which is only one of our areas In terms of members and officers working together as part of our principle two, we do know that the council's constitution has been reviewed, and the revised version agreed. We've been working to that for now, a complete cycle of council's business. And as part of that development process, we did undertake some member surveys in 2000, beginning this year, which gave all councillors the opportunity to comment on those particular changes. The leader has also reviewed the capital portfolios. I think it's clearly important, also on page 16, over page 70, is that the portfolio is now included in the Governance Commission Improvement Portfolio, which I think really demonstrates the strength and focus on governance and compliance with that particular responsibility being held by the Deputy Leader of the Council. In terms of promoting the values of the authority, again, you'll see that throughout Principle 3, some common themes and threads in terms of the code of corporate governance, the code of conduct of members, but the code of conduct for the staff as well, in terms of the values and principles and work that we've undertaken, that working with staff, they actually believe that the organisational values should centre around integrity, efficiency, confidence and ambition, or need we get into our governance arrangements. Principle 4, in terms of our taking informed and transparent decisions, again, our risk management policies now being formally agreed by cabinet, and something I know that the risk management committee has to keep a watchful brief on over the coming 12 months. We regularly present and have to to yourselves our assurance requirements, your responsibilities are highlighted in terms of what you need to oversee, we've got to manage your exit and contract procedure rules. And all the way, again, the common theme all the way through this is just how much progress we've made over the past 12 months. I think the conclusion of that particular principle it is never to get rid of that we are the administering body for the pension fund. Over £6 billion worth of responsibility that we have there. But in terms of the auditing for those accounts, demonstrates that we are having those to a high standard, and this demonstrates that effective arrangements are in place for the pension funds, so we wouldn't have those in place for the council. Principle 5, in terms of capacity and capability of members, again, we've just been referring to, Councillor Kelly's just been referring to, trying to bring in the opportunities for independent evaluation for that. We have appointed a full complement of permanent statutory personnel, so we do have the stability for the coming 12 months. In terms of engaging with local people, we obviously have the council's major budget consultation initiative. In terms of what really matters, that does provide a real opportunity for local residents to determine what they believe the council should be investing in. We move forward with our plans for neighbourhood working in the four constituency areas. All elected members are represented on the four constituency committees, and each constituency committee will be informed of the initial start-up grant, which is actually being increased this year to allow that local determination of control and also priority. Final thing I would say, Chair, just in conclusion around this particular statement is that we're trying to demonstrate here is that in terms of our corporate management assurance that the corporate risk management committee and the council as a whole, is that the council's chief executive strategy group takes full responsibility as responsible owners for corporate governance. I lead on that with the support of Mark and Serge and other colleagues in terms of our corporate governance group, which is highlighted in the second paragraph there. And then finally, just in terms of say, we are ensuring that it's recognised that we've come a long way, but that doesn't mean to say we can't make improvements. And paragraph 6 does identify the areas that we still look for. Focus on over the 13-14 period into 14-15 to make sure that you can be assured that's our next step for the same journey that we've had over the past 12 months. Jolene, Mark, and Lucy here to provide any additional support and comments.
Any questions?
Yeah, thank you, Chair.
Just any questions?
Yeah, thank you, Chair.
Just one question.
Yeah,
thank you, Chair. Just one
question. Looking at page 9, of course, we've just identified the framework. I've identified 6 core principles of good governance. I'm still very concerned about item 4, which is one of the main ones, that refers, of course, to effective scrutiny. And casting absolutely no aspersions on you, Chair, because I know you're a third person. I'm concerned about the principle of the executive group